Thank you for joining me for another edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Today I have on with me Ryan Tatusko of the Washington Nationals and Harrisburg Senators. As a Creighton fan for basketball and for baseball, I haven't been the one doing the heckling, but I've witnessed the horrible things people say to the umpires, say to the players on the other team.
Yeah.
Who do you think gets it worse, or do you think it's about the same, umpires or players?
You know, I think it's about the same, you know, but I think definitely, you know, the umpires get it worse. I mean, you know, it seems like that no matter what they do, they can't do anything right. I mean, at least for us, you know, if we go and throw a 9-inning shutout, it's going to be, people will acknowledge, hey, you know what, you actually threw a really good game right there. So people will acknowledge when we do something good, but it seems like every time an umpire steps on the field, they did something wrong. I mean, there could be a perfect game thrown, and you know there might have been that play that he dives in the outfield, did he trap it, did he catch it? That's going to be debated. You know, now especially with Quest Tech in the big leagues, you know, where they have the strike zone down to an absolute science with the computers and lasers and everything like that. It seems like that umpire's calls are getting so scrutinized that, you know, now with instant replay, it seems like, you know, every single thing that they do is under the camera and they have to be perfect all the time. So I would definitely say 100% the umpires get it a whole lot worse than we do.
Are you just saying that? Or do you mean that? Or are you just trying to get some extra calls next time you're playing?
You know, the extra calls aren't going to hurt this year, but no, I definitely think it's the umpires that get it. I mean, they make the right call. You got to figure they're always going to make somebody mad by making a judgment call. Either the home team or the visiting team is going to be really upset with a call. Either a bang-bang play at home plate, first base, whatever. One of the managers is going to be upset. You're not going to please them both all the time. So they're almost in a lose-lose situation all the time. And like I said, at least if we, you know, throw some scoreless innings up there, or, you know, someone hits a home run or 2-for-4 or something like that, then someone or most people are going to be happy with them, you know, that night. And if the umpire, you know, has a marginal call, he's going to make somebody mad. It's just inevitable. It's just a question of who, being it the managers or the umpire or the managers, the fans or the players.
What's the best ejection you've been a part of, like, on, like, I you wouldn't have been a part of the guy from the Braves who
No, but I have seen that YouTube video. I would say one of the better ones, I've actually been part of two really, really great ones. One happened last year, as a matter of fact, and one happened 2 years ago. One or 2 years ago we were at home, and well, actually 3 years ago, I was in high A, and our manager and we played in Bakersfield, and we were part of, we didn't draw very many fans. I mean, on any given night, you could probably count on one hand how many fans that we drew. And he went out and argued with the umpire, and obviously, we, you know, when they're face-to-face in an argument, he's going to have the questionable things to say, and you could hear every little word and detail that they were screaming and yelling at each other, and it was just echoing off all of the stands, and everybody could hear perfectly as it was being flared over a PA system, and it went on for about 10 minutes, and he just let loose into the umpire, and we heard every single word. There was zero crowd noise and zero music to stall any of it out, so everybody heard everything, and our dugouts were rolling because we couldn't believe that nobody was playing music to kind of let the manager have his peace. And then that was pretty funny just because we were able to hear every word, and it kind of made us uncomfortable, you know, kind of listening to it. But another one was last year when I was in AAA, and there was a questionable home run call down the left field line, and one of the managers grabbed a baseball and he walked into left center field and he threw the baseball over the right field wall and screamed, "Not when it's fair," and they threw another one into the stands and said, "That is foul." And that was actually pretty funny because he actually marched all the way out to the field, you know, to throw the balls fair and foul. And that was actually pretty clever.
I think I actually did see that on SportsCenter or something. I think I know what you're talking about there.
That one was actually pretty funny. We were all laughing. We were actually impressed that he thought of that off the top of his head.
But some of those, you got to think that there's got to be some Like, there's got to be some kind of plan to it, because some of those are just so clever that there has to be a, I mean, they have a team for everything now. Like, people have a publicist team. I bet managers have a ejection team where they decide how you're going to act when you get ejected.
You know, there's got to be something, or, you know, it's one of those things where they're sitting around, you know, with some of their friends, like, you know, it'd be really funny as if I just did, and then they get the opportunity, it's like, oh, man, I gotta go out and style, man, I gotta do this, and you almost wonder if some of that stuff is rehearsed.
Have you ever been ejected?
I have not. I've come awfully close one time when I was in low A, I was being immature and arguing balls and strikes, but I was arguing as I would walk off the field, and I would cover my mouth with my glove, and only the umpire could hear me, and I kind of bumped at him for about 4 to 5 innings before he got pretty upset at me and warned me that if I said one more word that I was going to go, and I kept testing the water with about 2 or 3 words, and he was waiting for one more, and I must have stopped at the right moment, and I never got ejected, but that was about the closest I was. It was in low A ball.
Is a, whenever your parents ever, like, does your mom ever say anything like, Ryan, you can't do that, like, if she ever sees that stuff on TV or anything?
Mom is always going to be a mom, and, you know, they're going to say, you know, if I get really upset, you know, I'm pretty good at containing my emotions, you know, on the field, and I think, you know, that's the mark of a great pitcher. You know, they always harp on us ever since, you know, we've been in Little League. You know, they should never be able to tell if you're having a good game or a bad game by your body language. And, you know, there's always a right time and place to ask umpires, you know, hey, you know, what was going on with that call? You know, was that down? Was that out? There's always ways to ask, you know, what was going on with a certain call, you know, in between innings or after a game or the next day. When you see them, you know, to not offend people. I think, you know, if you want to find, you know, the right answer, you almost kind of, you got to let the situation, you know, settle down a little bit. But, yeah, there has been a couple times, you know, where I've lost my cool a little bit, and, you know, I'll get it from both ends, from my fiance and from my mom both.
When you're in the heat of the moment and a player starts, like, were you part of the team when Bryce Harper started?
No, I was not. I was actually in AAA at the time.
How would you react to that as a pitcher? You saw Bryce do that to you. What would you do the next time you saw him?
You know, the whole thing is, you know, is when you throw at people, like, what I don't understand is, you know, is when you hit somebody, that puts a runner on first base. Now you have a potential RBI. You know, I've seen people get intensely hit, and it backfires horribly, and it starts a huge inning. And it's like, you know, okay, what point did you just prove right there? You know, you give up a 6-spot, man, that really showed us. I'm, you know, that really taught us a lesson. Now we're up 6-0, and that does anything any good. I mean, if it's me as a pitcher, I'm going to strike that guy out. I mean, I want to strike that guy out more than hit him. I think, you know, making him punch out in a big situation is a whole lot better than hitting him. I mean, yeah, you know, you're going to give him a bruise, and he's going to be upset, you know, for the next day, but he's going to be thinking a whole lot more of that run scored or that RBI that was hit behind him, and that, you know, when you're up 6-0, those bruises and scrapes and scratches really don't hurt as much as if you're down 6-0. So if I'm pitchers in, you know, in different situations like that, I'm going after the guy, and I want to either make him ground out into an inning double play to embarrass him, or I want to go after him and punch him out.
Well,
you know, obviously.
Would you send some chin music just to start off the at bat, and then go from there, and then punch him out, or would you just go after him from the get go?
It all depends on, you know, what the situation calls for. I mean, obviously, you know, everybody just saw what they saw on YouTube, you know, with what was going on, and obviously there had to be a backstory there. I mean, I don't think, you know, a player would, you know, do what they did on the field just out of the clear blue just to be, you know, that guy. I think, you know, there had to be more of a backstory, you know, of what was going on. And obviously, you know, the crowd and the public doesn't know. It's it only one of the players that were on the field that day and the coaches, you know, obviously know the backstory. But, you know, if people are going wrong, I mean, there's always a time and a place, you know. Obviously, you know, people are playing for their lives and their careers, and they have families and stuff. I mean, obviously, you don't want to attack somebody, you know, hit somebody in the head or anything like that and permanently injure them. But, you know, if you can, you know, throw something, you know, at the letters or something, you know, aim to knock them down to kind of send a message, you know, obviously there's a time and a place, you know, you protect your teammates. I mean, you know, that's kind of one of the unwritten codes of baseball is that you do what you can to protect teammates, but you definitely don't want to go out there, you know, to injure or, you know, severely hurt somebody because people are, you know, playing for a paycheck, and some people have, you know, fiancés and wives and families and stuff, you know, that they got to take care of. So it definitely is a fine line.
Now, Bryce Harper, he's a young kid. What is he, 19 now?
Yeah, I believe so, yes.
He's probably one of those people that every other team hates because he's so good and he's got an edge to him. But if he's on your team, you got to love him because
I definitely want a guy like that on my team.
Yeah, I mean, he's got that edge. He's got that fire. You know he wants to win. He's going to work his ass off to be the best player he possibly can be. I mean,
absolutely.
If you're looking at down the line here with this group you guys got, what's this? The sky's the limit. Do you think the sky's the limit for this organization right now? I'm looking at it from my perspective. I mean, you got a great young bullpen. Throw you in there.
Mm-hmm.
You got Clipper. You got Storin. And then you got Gio and Strauss in the starting lineup. I mean, you got Morse out in the lineup. I mean, you bring in Bryce Harper in that lineup, you guys got a shot to make some noise in the NL East. Where do you think you guys? Go ahead.
Like you said, you know, that's the scary thing is, you know, as everybody is so young that the maximum potential hasn't even been reached yet. I mean, there's still, you know, so much development. And once players, you know, start playing together and they start learning the nuances of each other, I mean, like you said, things can be scary. You know, obviously, you know, you have guys like Zimmerman and Jason Worth, you know, who have been around for a while, who can, you know, be the veteran, you know, guys in the clubhouse and kind of, and see how, you know, make sure everything's going right. And then, you know, you sign a guy like Brad Lidge, who is, you know, thrown through and not the final out of the World Series. I mean, that right there is just invaluable experience to have, you know, as part of a bullpen. And to be able to have young guys like you said, Storin and Clifford and, you know, and people like that, to be able to learn from somebody who's been in those situations before, I mean, that's just incredible experience. And I think, you know, the direction that the Nationals are going, like you said, I mean, they're going to be very scary in the NL East for a very long time to come. If everybody can stay healthy, I mean, as everybody knows, you know, that's the name of the game is, you know, stay healthy. And, you know, I think if they do, they're going to be very, very good and for a very long time.
How have you learned from these other guys that you've kind of come up with a little bit? What have you learned from somebody that maybe is a little younger than you, or even spending some time with Brad Lidge a little bit in this spring training? What's the main thing that you've learned that is going to get you personally to be a major contributor on this team for years to come?
You know, you learn kind of by watching people and kind of how winners go about their business, you know, and it always seems like, you know, they have a different way of going about, you know, things and kind of how they practice and how they take care of themselves. And, you know, maybe even a pitch grip, you know, just talking to somebody, you know, that has a great slider like a Brad Lidge or, you know, somebody down in the minor leagues. You know, I know all of us on the minor league side, you know, we talk every day about, hey, man, you know, your curveball's great today. How do you throw that? How do you grip that? What do you do, you know, or, you know, watching their slide step, you know, maybe if it's some way to control the running game or if it's mentality about hitters and pitchers and just kind of sharing knowledge about, hey, I would throw this pitch here because I would throw this pitch in this situation because, you know, there's, you know, there's, just like in any job, there's always information, you know, bouncing around, and especially, you know, within the organization, you know, everybody's a family, and so everybody, you know, sharing information to kind of make everybody better and, you know, really collaborate on things. But, you know, I think just kind of watching people about how they go about their business, I mean, I think that speaks volumes. I mean, you know, winners, you know, do things a certain way, and everybody wants to be like that. And if you can learn, you know, learn from those people firsthand, I think that's just, you know, an invaluable experience.
What's something you learned from LeBron James's body language on how not to handle yourself?
You know, that's a whole different thing. You know, basketball and baseball. You know, they're completely two different things, and I can't touch that with a 10-foot pole.
What is your opinion, or what's the feeling around baseball right now with the whole Ryan Braun situation? Or do you not want to comment on that?
You know, I don't think everybody knows the true story about what happens. I mean, obviously, you know, my grandparents, you know, had probably the greatest thing that I've ever heard in my entire life. And they said, my grandpa used to tell me, you know, Ryan, there's three sides to every story. There's what he said, what she said, and what really happened. And, you know, I think that's, you know, completely true in every situation, you know, and I don't think anybody's ever going to know completely about what that's happened, but I definitely think that, you know, the drug testing policy is going to be changed, you know, for us. But, you know, obviously if Brian Braun was truly innocent, like, you know, he says, and that, you know, that's the way this country is built on it. Innocent until proven guilty. And, you know, he was able to exonerate himself. And I think that, you know, he should be able to go forth as an innocent man. I mean, obviously he's an absolute incredible talent, you know, just to watch on TV and to watch him play the game. And, you know, his numbers, you know, speak for themselves.
Who is where do you stand on the drug testing right now? Do you think it's not tough enough? Do you think it's a like there's too much like is there like not too much but it's like they just ask you to do it at ridiculous times? Where do you stand on the drug testing policy right now?
I don't think they do that because they're ridiculous times. I mean, it obviously is random, and you have to keep it random. But, you know, when we show up at the field, you know, we'll have some drug testers there and things, you know, and they have certain regulations and things that they have to follow. And, you know, they definitely do the job, you know, with sealed containers and contamination-proof ceilings and things like that. But, you know, now with the implementation of blood testing things on the major and minor league side, I think, you know, that's just one more way to keep the playing fields level. I mean, you know, everybody wants to see a level playing field, you know, to kind of see what your skills versus my skills, you know, what they can do. And, you know, I think the drug testing policy is great the way it is. You know, obviously there's always going to be ways to beat the system. And, you know, it always seems like it's one of those things that there's catching up to do. And, you know, I think that as long as there's ways to beat the system is going to have to come, you know, to keep evolving. And I think, you know, right now that they're doing a great job. And I, you know, there's been no complaints, obviously. I think, you know, that the number of people who are testing positive is down, you know, a bunch from what it was in the very beginning. So that goes to show you that what they're doing is the right thing and that they really are doing a good job of cleaning up baseball.
Do you, well, you grew up in the, in the 90s with the with Sosa and McGuire, watching them
hit.
Oh, man.
And I was also a Cubs fan in my early days too, so I used to watch Sosa all the time.
Yeah, I mean, those were so, like, that baseball I don't think has gotten to the, like, it hasn't it's still just as fascinating. And anything can. I mean, look at what happened on the last day. There's never been a better last day to the season.
Absolutely.
And there never will be again because they have the new wild card. And
I
joke around on the show that they need to bring back steroids in baseball to so we can have Sosa McGuire again. But I mean, I don't think baseball pitching wise. It's never been better, and hitting-wise, I mean, I don't think these guys aren't bums. They're there for a reason. And
absolutely.
What do you think it is? Stronger pitching, or do you think the hitting's dropped off? What do you think?
You know, I definitely, you know, think it's stronger pitching. I mean, if you look back in, you know, the 70s and the 80s, and, you know, even if you go even far back in the 60s, I mean, there really weren't many guys throwing 90 miles an hour, let alone 100 mile an hour. And it seems like, you know, today's average, you know, whenever you break out the radar gun, the magic number, you know, is 90. And that's what everybody wants to see on the radar gun is, you know, how many times is this guy hitting 90 mile an hour and can he? You know, and I think just the pitching, it just goes to show you, you know, with the adding of, you know, weight training programs and conditioning programs and better nutrition and supplements and all the other auxiliary things that have, you know, come into baseball, I think the pitching has just gotten that much stronger. I mean, you know, you look at guys, you know, now you look at a guy like Justin Verlander, who's throwing 100 miles an hour well into his 100 and 110 pitches. And, you know, that was unheard of, you know, 5 and 6 years ago to have somebody do that. I mean, you had a guy like Nolan Ryan, who, you know, was my personal idol growing up, you know, he was touching 100 miles an hour and everybody thought that was nuts. And, you know, now you can just start name off people who throw 100 miles an hour, guys like Jordan Walden and Natalie Feliz and Verlander and, you know, there's so many others, you know, and Adolis Chapman. I mean, you got guys throwing 105 now. And, I mean, I just think, you know, it just shows that what pitching is becoming, and that I think that's forcing hitters, you know, to be better. And instead of, you know, kind of blaming it on veterans, I think people should be looking at the pitching that's going on now and kind of give some more credit to the better pitching that is going on, you know, in Major League Baseball right now.
Do you find it more, like, do you think you would have broken in easy, like, not easier, but you would have had a quicker impact in your career if you had come through in the age when pitching wasn't as dominant? Do you think you would have maybe gotten to the major leagues a little quicker, or do you not really know, or have you even thought about that?
You know, it's tough to say, because, you know, it's one of those things, you know, obviously if your pitching is faltering and the pitchers are just getting better around everywhere, then obviously organizations are going to start looking around, you know, for people who can get out. And I think, you know, throughout the ages, it's just who can get out, you know, that's who stayed there. And I mean, obviously, it doesn't have to be your hardest throwers. I mean, you have guys like Jamie Moyer and, you know, Cole Hamels, you know, who just have amazing stuff, but, you know, they aren't the hardest throwers, but they've been around forever just because they can get out. So, you know, I would say, you know, it's really tough to say, but, you know, I definitely think the pitching has gotten better exponentially, that's for sure, in the last 5 and 6 years.
What's your strength? What do you now? You don't have to tip your scouting report, but what's your favorite pitch to throw to get a guy out?
You know, I'm definitely, you know, it's my fastball. You know, I'm very blessed to be able to have great natural movement on my fastball. Depending on which side of the fence I'm putting on, I have a natural cutter and a natural sinker. My hand just kind of pronates that way. So, you know, I've been, you know, very fortunate to be able to throw kind of a natural sinker. And it seems like whenever that I need to get out of a jam, you know, I can go into that and induce the ground ball. You know, I'm definitely known as a ground ball pitcher, you know, and as long as I can keep the ball on the ground, you know, it obviously won't go out of the park, you know, so that's kind of what I try to maintain my focus on.
What pitch do you need has grown the most or improved the most since you've been at spring training or even in the last couple of years?
I would definitely, you know, say it was my changeup. You know, I fell in love with my breaking ball in college. You know, I developed a breaking ball extremely late, you know, when I was about 16 years old, and it just kind of came natural to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved being a fastball breaking ball guy in college, and that's, you know, what I was. And I kind of almost forgot about my changeup, you know, for a long time. And, you know, now being a pro ball, I've learned that the changeup, you know, is one of the most devastating weapons, because not only does it look like a fastball, but you can get a hitter on your front foot very easily. So I made it a point to really define, you know, my changeup, and it's still a pitch, you know, that I tinker with from time to time, because I still don't have 100% confidence with it all the time, and my confidence has definitely grown with it,
mm-hmm.
But it, you know, definitely a pitch that I like to tinker with and play with, you know, on a rainy day.
What do you go with, circle, or do you do three
fingers? Yeah, I go with more of a circle changeup right now, but you know, I've definitely, you know, experimented with grips, you know, with a Vulcan chain grip, a split chain grip. I've even thought about possibly throwing, you know, just a straight split finger fastball, you know, to get some more movement. But, you know, it's definitely, you know, it's never too late to add a pitch or subtract the pitch. So, you know, when that time comes, you know, maybe, you know, that's one of those things that, you know, you talk to veterans about, you know, is about, hey, what do you think about this pitch? You know, obviously, Roger Clemens, you know, developed his splitter very, very late, you know, in his career, and it probably added 5 or 6 years in his career just because he, you know, he went and mastered a new pitch and just became devastating for him.
Well, according to sources, that wasn't the only thing that prolonged his career. But I know what you mean. I'm just giving you a hard time. But
no, I understand.
The whole like Little League and all the like pressure that kids get put under these days of being all stars from the get go. The coaching has diminished as I've seen, because if, like, just watching, like, a Little League World Series, if that's not coaching. If a kid can just throw hard, they just tell him, go out there and strike the guy out, which, in kid's mind, that doesn't mean anything. He doesn't know what you're talking about. And do you think how much of your development do you wish you would have had because, like, maybe a coach didn't tell you to work on a changeup early on, or do you think success would have come earlier, or do you think that learning it now has bettered your development?
You know, it's one of those things, you know, you kind of look back on, and it, you know, hindsight is 50-50, and, you know, I definitely think, you know, kind of the way that I developed, you know, and I thank my parents, you know, for it, is just because, you know, the sports, you know, were fun for me when I was a kid. I think that's definitely what it has to be until you get to a certain point is, you know, I played baseball because it was fun, and I enjoyed the game, and I learned because I wanted to learn, and it wasn't forced upon me that, hey, you have to go play baseball. And it's like, you know, if I wanted to play basketball, great. You know, my parents, you know, we're all for me playing basketball. If I wanted to play baseball, fantastic, too. And for some reason, I couldn't convince my mom to let me play football, which I was kind of upset about. But, you know, growing up in India, it was mostly baseball, basketball anyway. But, you know, I kept it fun. You know, I played with my friends, and I played on my friend's team, and we played on the All-Stars together, you know, and we were all friends. And, you know, and that's some of the greatest memories that I have, is because, you know, at that time, it was fun. And I took, you know, lessons because it was fun for me, and it wasn't, you know, my dad breathing down my neck saying, you absolutely have to do this because, you know, you need to get a college scholarship. And, you know, the scholarships and, you know, being blessed enough to be drafted, you know, those things came, you know. But, you know, I definitely, you know, kept it fun. Even now, I mean, if you think about it as a job, and, you know, and I know I'm one of the incredibly, you know, lucky few that get to consider this my job, but, you know, it's still fun. I mean, you have to be able to go out and have fun in the game, and if you don't, then that's when you seriously have to start questioning why am I doing this? You know, if it does become, you know, a job, you know, then you have to question, you know, well, why? You know, why am I doing this then? Why, you know, is it supposed to be so stressful? Because it's, you know, playing a game for a reason and not working a game. So, you know, I definitely try to, you know, live by that motto and think, you know, by that motto that, you know, it's still called playing a game and not working a game.
Have you lasted longer in baseball than, say, somebody that might have been more talented than you because you didn't look at it as, I'm going out there and I'm, like, I mean, you want to make as much money as you can playing baseball.
Yeah.
But if you have the mindset of, like, if you're out there to make money and the treasure doesn't come right away, you're quicker to give up. Do you think your mindset has of, I'm out here to have fun, the reward will come at the end, has that allowed you to keep playing longer than, say, somebody that might have been more talented or somebody that might have had, like, a bigger name than you or whatever it might have been?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, definitely been the case, you know, and it's, you know, it all comes down, you know, to, like I said before, is, you know, it's that whole person situation. I mean, I've been incredibly blessed. You know, this is going to be my fifth year of professional baseball, and you know, all at various levels, and I've got to see and experience things that, you know, most people in the world will never get to do. And I've got to be in towns, you know, that I've never thought or probably never want to go back to, but you know, I've still been there. And, you know, it all just because, you know, I seen it as a game, and I've seen it, you know, as a blessing, and kind of, you know, just living one day, you know, for every day, and not worrying about, you know, what tomorrow's going to be. And I've definitely seen, you know, first and second rounders that have dropped after 2-3 years in pro ball just because they're so worried about how fast they're going to make it to the big league and how much money they're going to make in a big league that they really almost don't stop and enjoy the ride there. I mean, you know, that's happened really, you know, and I think there's a thing. It's not the thrill of the destination, but it's the, you know, the thrill of the journey that really makes it all worthwhile. And I think that's definitely what it is. You know, there's been a lot of people that just worry so much about how much money they're going to make in the big league. And, you know, like you said, obviously everybody wants to get there and everybody wants to have 10 to 15 years in the big leagues and they want to sign a $100 million contract. But if you keep everything in perspective, and if that's the only reason why you're doing something, then, you're going to be miserable. And I definitely think that you have to be in it for the love, no matter what you do, whether, you know, you're pushing papers in a mailroom somewhere or you're doing something else. You know, if you love what you do, then, you know, you'll never work a day in your life, to kind of quote another cliche. I feel like I'm in part of Bull Durham, but, you know, they're going over the cliches on the bus, but, you know, they're all true. I mean, and that's the reality of it, is they're all true, and I definitely think I've lasted a whole lot longer than people were talented me. I mean, there were a lot of people who were a whole lot more talented than me and still are, that aren't playing, you know, this game right now, and I still am. I mean, you watch a guy, you know, like Hunter Pence. I mean, you wouldn't tell a little leaguer to do things that he does, but, you know, that guy has a work ethic, and, you know, he just flat out wanted it more than the other people. And I think that, you know, true to, for a lot of baseball players, a lot of things that they do, you wouldn't go tell a little leaguer, hey, you know what, that's the epitome of what you should do right there mechanically, but you just can't teach heart and desire and the willingness to want it. And I think, you know, those are the three huge things that often get overlooked in the player.
Now, when you look back at some days in maybe college or before college, when maybe you could have made a when was that time when you decided that, all right, I have a chance at this, or the time when you thought you might have a chance at having a professional career? When did you realize that potential, and what gave you the confidence you could pursue that?
You know, I would say it was probably about right around my sophomore year in college. I played my sophomore year. I sat out my true freshman year due to Tommy John surgery as a senior in high school. So I missed the last half of my senior year and then my true freshman year in college. And I played my redshirt freshman year, and I went to the Alaskan Summer League, and I played for the Kenai Peninsula Oilers. And I was 21 at the time, so I was a draft-eligible sophomore, and there were some scouts up in the Alaskan League kind of watching the college talent, and I was approached after the draft for a free agent contract, and that's kind of when it really started to hit me that I might have the stuff, you know, to be able to play at the next level, and that's kind of when I really started thinking about, you know, that this is, you know, obviously a dream come true, and I'm going to do whatever I can, you know, to pursue this. So I would definitely say it was about my sophomore year in college when I, out of the blue, which I was totally not expecting, was offered a free agent contract.
What was the one you first got drafted by Texas? Who was the first person to come out of the woodwork that you hadn't talked to since high school to say, hey, Ryan, I haven't, I mean, we were like best friends in high school, and you hadn't talked to him in high school?
You know, it was, I come from a pretty small, you know, Indiana town. I mean, you know, it's grown huge now, but there were definitely some people, you know, I never really had the, hey, man, do you remember me? You know, we used to be in biology together. You know, hook me up with some tickets. You know, it was just a lot of well wishes that, man, I hope you make it, and, you know, give me some tickets, you know, to Arlington Stadium when you get to be in the big league, you know, one of those joking things. I mean, I was I was pretty fortunate enough to not really kind of have anybody come out of the woodwork, you know, and I definitely did not sign for enough money for people to be asking for money. That was pretty easy to deal with.
It must have been kind of a relief, too. A blessing and a curse.
Yeah.
A curse and a blessing.
It definitely is. I mean, you know, you see a bunch of people with so much money. I mean, I think there's a show on TLC about the lottery being cursed, you know, when they have people with all this money, and then all of a sudden people just start coming out of the woodwork, and they're trying to kill you, and they're doing all these crazy types of things just to get at your money. So I definitely, you know, like you said, I definitely think it's, you know, it's a blessing, you know, for me.
I think if I won the lottery, I don't think I'd tell a soul. It's kind of
hard now with all the media publications. It's almost kind of like they search you down. You'd almost have to move to, like, a country across the world and change your name and your passport and everything like that to not tell anybody. But those people who wish to remain anonymous, I totally understand why now. I really understand.
Well, I'm glad somebody else has researched that idea, too, because obviously you've done a little bit of research on winning the lottery, on how to keep your name anonymous.
It's almost too much work. I mean, to win it, I mean, obviously it's an incredible blessing, but, geez, it comes with so much pressure. Like I said, I was flipping through the channels, some time ago, and I watched, you know, how all these people, you know, just went bankrupt after the lottery because people just came out of the woodwork and, you know, it was like, hey, can I borrow $10,000? Can I borrow $20,000? Can I borrow $30,000? It's like, they wound up giving all their money away. It's like, holy cow, that's a whole lot of money to be given away.
I don't know how that happens. That's one of those, like, I mean, I understand how it happens. Because most of the people, like, somebody like LeBron James, well, no bad example, I mean, just somebody like Warren Buffett, he's not going to win the lottery because he never buys a ticket.
Yeah.
And all the people that buy the lottery tickets are the ones that their future depends on the lottery. So they've never been in a fortunate situation, so they don't know how to handle themselves. How much trouble did you have handling yourself your first couple of years with being off on your own, not just in college, but now your job is baseball, not you have school, then baseball.
Yeah, I really didn't have, you know, much trouble because obviously college, you know, really prepared me to kind of be on my own. I mean, I went to college about 2.5 hours away from home, so I was able to jump back home, you know, whenever I wanted to. Whenever I was really feeling homesick, you know, I was able to go back home. So when I was drafted, you know, I kind of already had 3 years of being gone in the summers, you know, in Alaska and in Wisconsin, and then being gone all year, you know, for college and things. So, you know, when I hit pro ball, you know, and I was by myself, I mean, it really was pretty easy. And it's nice, too, you know, I've been fortunate enough to play in towns that have been close enough to Indiana. I played in the Midwest League in Iowa, where we traveled all around Indiana. My family got to see me there, and obviously they came out to Indiana. And my mom, you know, and my dad, you know, try to make trips out to see me throughout here, even now, you know, I mean, it does get hard when you don't see your family, you know, for 8 or 9, 10 months at a time, you know, especially, you know, last year when I played winter ball in Venezuela, I was gone, you know, 2.5 months longer. But, you know, it gets hard, but, you know, people, you know, you definitely try to make time to see each other, you know, throughout the year, and that kind of breaks up everything, and, you know, it really helps.
How scary was it when you found out about Wilson Ramos when he got kidnapped?
You know, it was pretty crazy to hear. I mean, you almost didn't know what to think. You know, the team that I was on, the Margarita Bravos, did such an incredible job with security. I mean, guys had girlfriends and fiancés and wives. I mean, we had a baseball royalty and Don Baylor as our head coach. I mean, you know, the guy's been in the game 40 years, plus his players, managers, coaches, everything. And, you know, it was almost like, you know what, you know, if he feels safe, then I feel safe. But, you know, they did such an incredible job of security at the games and bodyguards, you know, when we're on the road and bodyguards on our team buses when we're on the mainland. So, you know, I never felt a sense of, you know, being of any sort of threat. And the Nationals, you know, called every single one of the players, you know, within the organization down there immediately. I mean, we were contacted within that day to make sure that we were okay. And, you know, they just kept reiterating us, you know, to let us know that we had the option of coming home and they weren't going to be upset if we felt, you know, unsafe at all. And, you know, they would periodically call and get a hold of us, you know, to make sure that we were still safe and to check on us. And that was comforting as well to know that, you know, your organization cares about you and they're thinking about you to make sure about your safety. And, you know, obviously, you know, nothing happened, you know, and he was returned safely, but, you know, it was scary, but, you know, at the same time, like, when I looked around and I saw how protected we were and, you know, what measures that my team did to make myself and my fiance feel safe. I mean, there was never doubt in my mind, you know, how safe we were down there.
How's he doing? Is he doing okay after that?
You know, when our team, you know, saw him down, and then a bunch of, you know, his friends that were on my team, you know, knew him, and he was taking batting practice. He was launching balls out of the stadium. I think he was doing just fine.
Wow, I can tell you, if I had been kidnapped or whatever, I would never think of taking batting practice within a week after that. That would be...
It was right near about a week after they found him. He was already on the field ready to go, and, you know, that's, you know, almost what some people need is just to get back to a sense of normalcy, and, you know, and things are fine. I guess, you know, different people cope with it in different ways. You know, that was just, you know, his way of doing it. But, you know, from what I understood from my teammates, you know, when we were down there, when we saw him, you know, he was just fine.
Now, before I let you go, I want to know where you, what are your personal, I want three goals this year. One personal, one for your team, or one minor league goal and one major goal.
My personal goal is to make my debut this year. You know, obviously, it's something that I've been working toward, and, you know, I worked this off season, and, you know, like I said last year, if you look at my numbers, it doesn't, you know, doesn't take a stat genius to see that I had an awful year. I mean, if there's another word for awful, you know, that you can use that too, and, you know, but I think, you know, I learned so incredibly much from that year about how to fail and how to, you know, and how to pick myself up and keep going and how to handle myself, and I think that's just, it was knowledge that I needed, and that was, you know, God's way of, you know, saying, hey, you know, this is, you're going to fail, and this is how you handle it, and I think that was just invaluable, you know, to my experience, you know, doing that. So I think definitely my personal goal is to be in the big leagues at some point in 2012, be it the last day of September or the first day in April. I mean, at some point I want to spend some time up there. A minor goal, minor league goal that I want to do, you know, is I want to see our, you know, hopefully, you know, I start where I ended off last year in AAA, and, you know, I want to see the team make the playoffs. You know, I know Syracuse hasn't been to the playoffs, you know, in a long time, and, you know, I think it'd be great, you know, for us to go back to the International League playoffs, and I think definitely, too, that, you know, and that's the goal, you know, with... I want to make my major goal would be that when I get to the big leagues, that I want to have a positive contribution to the big leagues. I want to help. You know, obviously, they wouldn't bring me up, you know, without expecting me to help. And, you know, I want to be able to help and be a cog, you know, in the bullpen or the rotation or the clubhouse, you know, wherever it is, you know, that they need help with, you know. And I want to do my part, and, you know, hopefully, you know, go to the playoffs, you know, for. And, you know, kind of start a run to where it's expected that the Nationals, you know, go to the playoffs and kind of be known as a part of the team, you know, that started all that.
Now, when you get up to the big leagues, not if, I'm making this a when. When you make it up to the big leagues, who's somebody that you have unfinished business with from the from minor leagues that you want to see again, that you want, that they got the best of you and you want some revenge?
That's it. That's actually an easy one. That'd be Mike Moustakas.
Whoa.
I came up against that guy.
I did see him play last year in Omaha.
He did play in Omaha, yes. He came up, the Royals and the Rangers obviously share spring training complexes together, and I came up with him at every level, starting, you know, in low A ball, and he always got me. I mean, it wasn't home runs or doubles and triples, but he, it always seemed that, like, you know, I would jam on the fence and he'd bloop it over the shortstop head, or I would go after and try to break his bat, you know, and you know, he'd find a way to kind of, you know, hit one, you know, into the gap. Or he always kind of seemed like he got the best of me. So he's the one guy that, you know, that always stuck in my head. I think every pitcher kind of has that guy that when he comes to the plate, you're like, oh, no, not him. And he's definitely my guy. I mean, you know, he's gotten the better of me, you know, more times than I've gotten the better of him. So he's definitely a guy, you know, that I would look forward to seeing, you know, when and if I get to the big leagues this year.
He's a hell of a guy on MLB 2K11. I know that.
He's a hell of a player in real life. Let me tell you, it is impossible to break that guy's bat, and I have tried multiple times. It is. I'm pretty for sure it's impossible. I haven't solidified that yet, but I'm about pretty for sure it's impossible to break his bat because I've tried multiple times.
All right, we're going to play a little hypothetical game.
Okay.
All right. Or actually, it's going to be Would You Rather. It's going to be, I'm going to have to edit this because it's going to sound awful, but it's going to be, would you take, or what's going to happen first?
Okay.
You make it to the big leagues, or you look like Bob Wickman at the end of your career?
I'm making to the big leagues.
Good. I'm glad that you chose not to go with looking like that. I'm sure your fiance wouldn't like that.
No, not at all.
Which is going to happen first? You get ejected for corking your bat, or you leaving the park in batting practice at Wrigley Field?
Getting ejected for corking my bat. if anybody can tell you, if anybody who listens to this has seen me swing, they can tell you exactly what it looks like, and it's not the prettiest thing in the world.
Okay. Next one. The Ozzie Guillen gets tossed from 5 playoff games, or the Nationals win the World Series?
Nationals winning the World Series, that's definitely going to happen first. With the amount of talent that they got on their team, mm-hmm. it's inevitable that it's going to happen.
Yeah, I'd like to. All right, that game is over. I think we did a pretty good job on that. I had to come up with those on the spur of the moment, but
that was pretty good.
Yeah, I thought I did pretty well. I've struggled the last couple of days. I've interviewed some Lingerie Football League players. And
I'm sorry that I'm the downfall of this week.
Oh, you're definitely not a downfall. I had some problems coming up with questions there. And I got a little nervous. But what's the key with them is they I try to come up with these question games and there'd be a delay and they wouldn't get the full effect of the joke on the comments. So the game's kind of tanked on the air. So I had to kind of work with those interviews to change it so that I didn't look like such a jackass. But when you see this upcoming season for the Nationals, Jason Worth has gotten he's gotten a bad rap for the contract that the Nationals that he signed with the Nationals for the big money. However, I think for that money, I think you're getting an enormous amount of a guy that has the World Series experience. He has that it factor that maybe you don't want to pay that much money for, but if it results in a World Series and he's on that team, you know he had a part in it.
Absolutely, he had a major part in it.
Well, what have you seen from him that that you know that he's going to come back with a bang this year?
You know, I think, you know, like anybody, you know, I think everybody got on him, you know, for possibly having a down year, but, you know, for how great of a player he was, you know, and his down year is the average year of any other superstar, you know, and his great years are greater than, you know, 99% of the big leaguers. And, you know, I think, you know, he's definitely going to come back, you know, with a vengeance this year, and especially, you know, with how much hype and potential is on this team. You know, I definitely, you know, think that he wants to be, you know, him and, you know, Ryan Braun and Michael Morris, you know, all those guys, not Ryan Braun, I'm sorry, Ryan Zimmerman, and Michael Morris, you know, those guys, you know, definitely want to be the key components of that lineup, and I think, you know, he's going to do what he has to do to prove that, you know, he belonged there.
Who's going to be the first phone call you make when you get that call to the big leagues? Who are you going to call? And I don't want you to
be my mom.
I don't want you to say.
I'm actually going to try to. I would try to conference call my mom and my dad at the same time to kind of. No, they can't, you know, be upset about who I called first, but my fiance is still finishing college, so she travels with me, so she's definitely going to be the first person I know, but, you know, my parents are definitely going to be the first people that I call.
And one last thing, who's somebody that you don't want to talk trash about, but you want me to give a little piece of my mind to them?
Oh, you know, I really don't have any animosities, you know, towards anybody. I would have to say no one.
No one, dang it.
Not even
like a actor or a celebrity that gets on your nerves or anything.
Yeah, I'm pretty much an easygoing guy. You know, it's hard to really upset me. You know, kind of trivial things like that. I just kind of let it go, and one of those, you know, to each his own.
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. I try to do that, but sometimes I gotta burn on some things. What's on your DVR right now?
Big Bang Theory and Shark Tank.
Shark Tank. What's Shark Tank?
Shark Tank is it's got Mark Cuban, and it's got a bunch of billionaire startup founders and aspiring entrepreneurs come in and they pitch their business ideas to these entrepreneurs and they basically beg them for funding help to kind of start up their business. And it's actually kind of cool to listen and see, you know, what these people did and how they came up with their businesses and listen to see if they get investments. And I mean, I'm kind of a geek that way. I have a business management, business administration major from Indiana State, so I kind of like watching business shows like that. So I love watching Big Bang Theory, and from my teammates and things, I've heard that Breaking Bad is a new show to get into, so I think that's going to be my next show that I try to get into.
What, were you ever a fan of The Shield?
You know, I never really got into that. You know, I kind of like watching, I like watching shows, you know, straight through. Two and a Half Men was a great show. I really liked it with Charlie Sheen.
Oh, yeah.
I really haven't seen it much with Ashton Kutcher. I definitely think, you know, Charlie definitely made that movie, but I'm the type of guy where I just want to watch episodes, you know, boom, 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 boom. I can't watch an episode, wait a week. Watch an episode, wait a week. So I try to watch, you know, I kind of wait till they get released on DVD and then just, you know, sit and just kind of have a marathon with it, and that's kind of what I really like there. And I've also heard Game of Thrones is an amazing TV show to get into as well.
Oh, yeah, I've heard good things about that.
I've heard great things about that show, too, so I think Breaking Bad and Game of Thrones are going to be the next two shows that I try to get into.
Well, that sounds like you got a pretty full schedule. When when does spring training come to an end for you?
The minor league side comes to an end on April 1st is when we kind of find out our assignments, and I think that's our final day, which is weird. I don't think the big leaguers end until the 3rd.
Oh, so are you planning any April Fool's Day tricks for any teammates that day?
You know, those things are kind of, you know, spur of the moment. I feel like if I release them, I say, yeah, you know, people are going to be looking for them. So I'm going to say no and kind of let people be surprised.
Well, that'll be good. You'll have to let me know what you do for that April Fool's Day prank.
I will, absolutely.
Is there anything else you want to talk about before I let you go then?
I am good. You've covered a multitude of topics. We've been everywhere with this conversation. It's been a great time.
Yeah, you know, that's what happens when you have ADHD. It kind of, the topics kind of bounce around from place to place. It's like a pinball machine.
It's been great.
Yeah, well, I'd love to do this again. I had a great time. I The lingerie football women are a lot of fun to talk to, but as far as you know, going from topic to topic, they're not as easy to talk to, you know. and they don't take their jokes as good. So.
Well, I'm glad I brought something to the table, because I'm pretty for sure they had me quite licked in the looks department.
Well, you would make the looks department, I think. You'd be like, I don't know, like Brad Pitt, maybe.
In a very different way.
Yeah, but, I mean, you got the voice to, like, I look like a kind of a washed out 80s sitcom, like a child actor. I kind of look like one of those kids, but I would say that I'm good for radio, because nobody wants to look at me, and I mean, that's
everybody
what you
everybody looks good over radio.
That's right, yeah, because I guess that was kind of the thing I missed with the Lingerie Football League players, is nobody got to look at them, because it's over, they just hear their voice, so.
Exactly.
So, well, hey, April Fool's Day, should we do this again? We'll find out your assignment, and we'll follow your season from there.
Yeah, that sounds great. Absolutely.
So, all right, Ryan, I appreciate it, and good luck with the rest of spring training. Keep in touch, and we'll do this again real soon, then.
All right, thank you very much.
All right, thanks. Thank you for joining me for that edition of the Bob Sullivan Show. Check out any episodes you may have missed on YouTube.